been in a situation in life where you just knew that God was leading you somewhere? You knew you were in his will. You knew you were going where he was leading up until the very moment when it seemed like he wasn't. You know what I mean? Like where it seems like the road is clear, the path is clear, and God is moving you and leading you to a certain point, and then you get there, and then you look around and like, wait a second, where did he go? I know I may have shared this story a while back, but it fits the moment. When Beth and I lived in Illinois, it was in the Chicagoland area, and the housing market was just ridiculous out there. And so we lived in this little rental, and we really wanted to buy something. And family was getting bigger and having more kids, and okay, we want to settle down a little bit. We want to purchase a house. So we're looking everywhere, mostly for foreclosures and all that kind of stuff. There's nothing really within our price range at all. And then finally, we find this house. It's drastically reduced. It's a pre-bank approval short sale. I didn't know what that was before that moment, but I learned. It was definitely a stretch, and it was going to be everything we got, but it was at least attainable. And it was there was a layout, the design that we were looking for. It was in a neighborhood that was close to the church, and we were just excited. Like, man, this is it. This is our house. So we were so excited, and so we met with the realtor, and we she said, hey, you should probably offer more than the asking price. We're like, ouch, but okay, we will, just to make sure this happens. Then we find out that it's currently owned by a worship pastor at another church, and we're like, God, this is you, right? And so we, with our, with when we submitted our offer, we also submitted a letter that says, you know, hey, we're pastors in the area as well, youth pastor, this and that, never hurts to put a little extra. But so we threw that in there. Well, like, God, you're just the way that you're bringing this together, and the pastor connected, this is great. And so we submitted our offer. There was a number of offers that submitted that same weekend, but ours got accepted. We're buying a house. And we were like so pumped. And then about a week later, we get the notice that the bank, though the sellers approved our offer, the bank didn't approve the offer. And it was just like, God, first of all, God, I didn't know that was a thing. And second, what in the world? God, you know that was top. Like, there's nothing else we can do now. God, like, you like lined all this up, and like, this is just what we want. God, you provided all this for us right here, right now, and then just to like take, you know, pull the rug out from under our rug out from under our feet. Less than a year later, get a. Well, I'll back up even before that. In that period of time, shortly thereafter, God was speaking to Beth and I that He was going to make a transition in our life and ministry. And I was a youth pastor at the time, and really sensed God speaking to my heart that He was going to move me into a position of adult ministry. Okay. Shortly thereafter, I get contacted by the church that we'd been a part of in Missouri, very, very large church, asked if I'd be interested in throwing my name in the hat for the small groups pastor position at this very, very, very large church. My first thought was, what in the world? Why are you asking me? But sure, yeah. I mean, this is a dream job. Dream job. And it progresses, and I have some conversations and fill out all the application stuff, and it gets down to just me and a couple other guys. And in this process, and you know, I know they're going to be making some decisions pretty soon, and I'm getting anxious for this. I'm like, God, this is like the church I grew spiritually more than any other time in my life, and the church I served under. I love the pastor. I love his teaching. The way that he preaches is affected the way I preach. And then I get a phone call from one of my buddies from college, and he says, hey, so, you know, James River's hiring a small groups pastor. And I thought, oh, yeah, he heard that I'm applying. And he says, Well, hey, I know you went to church there for a number of years, so you know the church really well. I was just wondering if you could give me some tips or some input, because I have an interview for the job with the pastor next week. What? I didn't even know you. Oh, and so here, one of my best friends from college is asking me to coach him through an interview for a job that I want. My God, what's going on? God, I thought you were in this. God, I thought this is what you wanted. God, you're walking me through this. I just sense, like, God, you even spoke to my heart that there's going to be a transition in my life and ministry. God, I know that there's, what happened? But you know, this type of things is something that many of us we face in life in a variety of different ways, right? I mean, it could be something where, you fall in love with that special someone, you get married, you're honoring God in your relationship, you're ready to settle down and have kids, only years into your marriage find out that you are unable to have kids. God, what are you doing? You're ready to retire, you're 2 years from retirement, and you're ready, you want to use all your free time to serve God and serve the church, and you're going to take on these volunteer ministry opportunities, and you're so excited to engage in his work, only to find out that finances got flipped around and some things fell through, and you got 10 more years of full-time work to do. You always pictured yourself as having a spouse and getting married one day, but all of a sudden you look around and go, I am an adult and I am single and I've got no prospects. God, what are you doing? We find these types of things happen in life all the time where it seems as if we know where God is going, and then it's as if in the last moment he's nowhere to be found. See, this is what the disciples ran into the night they were sitting around the table with Jesus. We're going to continue in our study of John in John chapter 13, and we're going to bleed into chapter 14. So if you've got your Bibles, you can turn there. You see, the disciples knew where Jesus was going, right? We've talked about this the last several weeks. It seems like the intro to every sermon has been the same recently because we've been discussing one dinner party. And so just to catch us all up to speed, here they are. They are excited because they know where Jesus is going. Jesus is going to the throne of Israel, right? They know where they're following Jesus. Jesus is going to be the ruler of the people of Israel. That's where they're following. Because the Old Testament says, the Bible itself says that's what's going to happen. That God, that the Messiah is going to rule and reign in peace and prosperity. That's what the Messiah is going to do. Well, they just got their timing a little off, but that's what they saw. And that's where they were following Jesus. And so they're sitting around this table, ready to crown him king. And then he gets up and he begins to wash their feet. And he says, I want you to wash each other's feet. And they're like, Jesus, I think you forgot. Like, when you're king, you'll have lots of servants. And when I'm one of the rulers in your kingdom, Jesus, I don't know if you're my, there will be plenty of servants to wash our feet. I don't know what you're talking about. See, they knew where Jesus was going, and then he gave some indications that he may not be going there. And then he drops the bomb in the room, right? One of you sitting around the table with me right now is going to betray me. So where we ended last week, Judas had just left, and we get the picture that around the table, most of the guys don't even know that it's Judas. In fact, remember, it says, John says that when he left, most of them thought, Jesus said, you know, go do what you need to do. They thought that Jesus had given them an assignment to go get some things ready for the rest of the weekend. Yeah, maybe John knew, maybe Peter knew, Jesus knew, but we get the impression that nobody knew who it was. And here they are, they're sitting around the table, in shock that one of their closest friends would betray them, would betray Jesus. And that's where we pick up in our story today. Everybody just kind of still stunned from this announcement. And it said, when Judas was gone, Jesus said, now is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify the Son and himself and will glorify him at once. What does this mean? Let me just recap this simply. The last time Jesus spoke about the Son of God and being glorified, it was just a few days prior to this when we read it in, a few actual days in the story prior to this event. We looked at it a few weeks ago. In John chapter 12, he says, the Son of Man, now is the time for the Son of Man to be glorified, and went on to speak of the cross. Disciples aren't quite picking it up, and so Jesus softens a little bit. He continues with my children. You ever have to deliver news that you know the person who you're speaking to is not going to like it? You have to, as an employee, or as an employer, you have to let one of your employees go. So you try to soften it up front as much as possible, but you know it's going to hurt. You have to break the bad news that the plans that your kids are looking forward to aren't going to take place like they were, and you're just like, okay, my children, just listen. And he softens, he tries to soften the room, my children. He knows they're not going to like it. He knows they're in a very, very vulnerable state. So you see the heart of God coming out through Jesus here. He says, my children, I'll be with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and just as I told the Jews, so I'm telling you now, where I'm going, you cannot come. He continues, a new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. You see, what's on Jesus' mind is he's saying, listen, I know you're not going to like this, but you got to hear me. I'm going to leave and you can't follow me. And so since I'm gone, this is what I want you to know. Remember when we were talking, we were out in public and it was asked of me, what's the greatest commandment? I said, love God and love people. I wasn't kidding. And this is the command I want you to live out now. I want you, this seems like the most obvious thing to do. I am known by the way that I love people. I am known by the way that I care for people. I am known by the way that I respect and honor and love and cherish people. I want you as my followers to represent me well. I want you as my followers to do the same thing. I want you to love in the same capacity that I have loved you. I mean, this is going to be the number one evidence that you're mine. That if you love people in extraordinary ways. That's what's on Jesus' mind. And we talked a little bit about that a couple weeks ago when we looked at the washing of the disciples' feet. But I want to continue in our storyline. That was on Jesus' mind, but it was not on the disciples' mind. They couldn't get past. I mean, they're still in shock. And Peter, totally missing the whole love part, goes back to his prior statement. He says, Simon Peter asked him, Lord, where are you going? I want you to think about this. Here, these 12 disciples. Here, these guys. They've given their lives to following Jesus. Let me just put it this way. What is the definition of a disciple? A follower of Jesus, right? A follower, really a follower. You could be a disciple of anybody. A disciple is one who follows, right? The life and teaching of somebody. A disciple is a follower. These 12 guys. I mean, Jesus had tons of disciples. They were all over. They'd come out, they'd listen to him, and they honored him, and they liked him, and all this kind of stuff. He had lots of disciples, but these 12 were specially chosen. See, today we call ourselves disciples, right? We're a disciple of Jesus. Those who've put their faith and hope and trust in Jesus, received his salvation from him because of death and resurrection. We are the disciples of Jesus, right? But we can be disciples, and we can follow Jesus, but then we can go to work tomorrow. And we can follow him at work. But these 12 were different. I mean, Jesus had people that time too who they followed him, but they went to work. And then they found where he was, and they listened to his teaching. These guys are different. When Jesus said, follow me, to these 12, it was an invitation to forsake everything they've known. To walk away from everything that they've ever known. Their jobs, they closed the door on their jobs, they walked away, and they are giving himself completely and wholly to literally following Jesus everywhere he went. When he wakes up, they wake up. When he eats breakfast, they eat breakfast. When he goes minister, they minister with him. When he goes and travels, they're right there beside him. When he goes and heals, they heal along. When he preaches, they preach with him. When he goes to bed, they go to bed. They were followers of Jesus. And we got to get this. That was their whole identity, was in following Jesus around. And here Jesus is leading them, and he's been leading them, and now they think they know where they're going. They think they're right on the precipice. They think they're right there, right before all this excitement is about to take place. They're right there, and right where they think Jesus is leading. And then Jesus says, listen, you can't follow me any further. Thank you for the last 3 years, but I'm going to leave, and you can't come. Imagine the impact of that. And so when he goes on to, oh, and love one another, they missed that. Because they were stuck on, wait, where are you going? And why can't I follow you? And so Peter has this interaction with Jesus here. He said, Jesus, or Peter says, Lord, where are you going? Jesus replied, where I'm going, you cannot follow now, but you will follow later. You know, this language sounds very similar to what he said earlier in the evening as they're sitting around the table. Remember when Jesus is getting ready to wash Peter's feet, back in verse 6, 7, 8 in there, Peter says, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? And Jesus says, you don't realize now what I'm doing, but later you will understand. What was he saying? He's saying, trust me. You don't understand now, but you will later. Trust me. Again, he says a similar language to Peter again. He says, you can't follow where I'm going now, but you will be able to follow later. Just trust me. Just trust me. And Peter asked, Lord, why can't I follow you now? And I can only imagine things running through Peter's mind. Okay, so he just told us somebody's going to betray him. So is he like fleeing? Is he going? Like, is he going to hide? Does he not trust me that I'm going to defend him to the death? Like, what's going on? Why would you? Are you going to afraid that you're going to put me in harm's way? Jesus, I don't care about any of that. Lord, why can't I follow you now? He says, I'll lay down my life for you. I'll lay down my life for you. See, Peter just doesn't understand what's going on. And Jesus is not ready to show his hand. And he simply says, trust me. Now, imagine being Jesus. Okay? The death. His death is imminent. And not only that, he just sent his betrayer on his way as he's currently, while this conversation is taking place, Jesus knows that Judas, one of his close friends, one who's about to betray him, is on his way to Caiaphas and the leading priests to get them to come arrest him. He knows that this group that he's sitting here with, in a matter of hours, are going to flee in fear and disbelief. He knows that he's facing the darkest moment of his life. He's facing the greatest anguish he will ever go through. All that while knowing the guys he's having dinner with are about ready to desert him. He's trying to be gentle and he's trying to be fatherly. My children, I need to tell you something. I'm going to go and you can't follow me. And Peter starts to get all worked up. Why? How come? Why? Sounds like one of my kids. Why? Right? And in this boldness, I'll even die for you. Man. I've said it a number of times through the story, but I'm so glad I'm not Jesus, because I would not have handled this very well. Peter. You know what's going to happen to Peter. And Jesus tells him, will you really lay down your life for me, Peter? Oh, really? Is that what you're going to do? You're going to lay down your life for me? I tell you the truth, before the rooster crows, before the sun comes up, before you eat breakfast tomorrow, you will disown me 3 times. I believe it's Matthew. It says, you will deny that you even know me. You know, Peter gets a bad rap and all of this. And yes, Peter is the one that just outright denied Jesus. But Jesus actually, in Matthew and Mark, it talks about Jesus doesn't just address Peter in this. John just gives us a smaller piece. Matthew and Mark give a little bit more detail on this. It actually says Jesus, in Matthew 26, says, then Jesus told them, this very night, you will all fall away on account of me. And after he told Peter that he was going to deny him, it says that Peter said, even if I have to die with you, I'll never disown you. And all the other disciples said the same. This wasn't just a conversation between Jesus and Peter. This was a conversation with the whole table. So here, they're sitting there, and so Jesus starts washing their feet, and that's all bizarre. Then there's a betrayer, and nobody knows what to do. And then Jesus says, okay, I'm about now. Listen, I know you followed me this far, but now I'm going to leave. And they're like, I don't understand. And then he says, listen, you're all going to leave me. And nobody knows what to do. Jesus doesn't make any sense. Like everything was going so well, and now it's all falling apart. You're telling me that we're going to desert you? You're telling me that Peter, of all of us, is going to deny he knows you? Like one of us is going to turn you on? Like this doesn't make any sense. God, this is not where you're going, and this is not what I signed up for. We've all been there, haven't we? God, this is not what I expected. God, I saw this playing out way differently. Jesus, I could see you. You led me to this point. To what? See, that's when we begin to ask questions. And we're going to see the disciples doing the same thing. They're riddled with questions. They're full of fear. They're full of uncertainty. They're full of doubt. They're super confused. They don't know what's going on. They don't know which side is up. Everything's been turned around on them. Nothing's happening and playing out like it's supposed to be playing out. And they're full of questions. Peter asks, why? It's the first question we typically ask, right? Why would you let this happen? Why would you lead us up to this point and then do this? Why would you give me this false hope? Why would you allow me to walk through what I walked through? Why won't you let me know what's going to happen? Why? And Jesus' simple answer is just trust me. I hate that answer, don't you? Right? My kids hate that answer just as much. It's the equivalent of saying, because I said so, right? But why? Because I said so. All that means is you need to trust me. When you're walking through that thing, you're like, God, I thought I saw this out. God, everything was going well, but now everything's not, and everything's turned upside down. It's like you've turned it all on its head, and I thought I was following you. Now I have no idea where you went. God, why? And what his voice to you today is, trust me. Trust me. You know, trust is hard because trust inevitably requires patience. We don't have to trust for something that happens now, right? Just by definition. And I hate patience. I mean, I hate being patient. Even when I'm doing it well, I hate it, right? Like, even when you're like, okay, I got this patient thing. I know I got to wait, but I still hate waiting. I want answers. But Jesus so often says, trust me. Sometimes he lets us see the why. The other 99 times out of 100, he just says, trust me. And that's where Jesus and Peter were right then. So Jesus continues, and he says, do not let your hearts be troubled. I just want to pause there for a moment. This is Jesus who is in the process of being betrayed. This is Jesus who's going to the cross. We talk about Jesus is in a rough spot, a dark hour right now. And this is what he says. Don't let your hearts be troubled. Jesus' heart is as troubled as it's ever been, and he puts the disciples' well-being above his own. Who does that? I mean, he doesn't just put up with them. He loves them to the very end, like we saw in the beginning of chapter 13. He says, I'm going through something that none of you have a clue about. I'm personally, right now, going through something that nobody could even imagine or fathom. I'm about to bear the wrath of God for the sin of the world. And yet his words to his disciples are this, don't let your heart be troubled. He cared about their emotional well-being, which is just shocking. But he goes on, he says, trust in God, trust also in me. And there it is. Peter, you got these questions, and I can't give you answers right now, but you just have to trust me. In my Father's house, there are many rooms, and if it were not so, I would have told you, I'm going to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place. You know the way to the place I'm going. See, listen, you got to trust me. You got to trust that I have your future in mind. You got to trust that I have your best interest in mind. You've got to trust that I am going to take care of you. You've got to trust that the end game is that I would be with you and that you would be with me. That's what Jesus is giving him the assurance. Because I can't tell you where this journey is going to go. I can't tell you where I'm going to go. I can't answer all my questions. But I want you to know this, that if you trust me, I'll take care of you. That if you trust me, you've got nothing to fear. That I know it's not playing out the way that you want it to, but if you trust me, I will take better care of you than you can take care of yourself. So trust me. First question, why? And then Thomas pipes up, and he asks another question. In verse 5, Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way? Seems like a pretty legitimate question. Have you ever tried to use your GPS to help give you directions to somewhere without putting the destination in? It's not very helpful, right? You'll just drive around with a little blue dot on your screen. Like, it's not going to help you at all. You've got to have a destination. He says, Thomas is saying, we don't know where we're going. So how can we know the way? You're leaving, and all we've ever done is followed you. We don't know where we're going or how to get there. It's kind of like when I was in college, I would drive the vans to play basketball on our road trips or whatever, and I was always the follow van, right? So I never had the map. I never had the GPS. Thinking GPS might have been pretty sweet and new at the time. I think it was probably a map. Anyway, but they never had a map. It didn't have a GPS. I just had the back bumper, right? And so we'd travel all over the place, from Missouri to Texas and played in Iowa, and we played all the way out to, like, the East Coast. But today, I could not get to any of those places because I never looked up. I was just looking at the bumper of the car in front of me. You see, the disciples were just looking at the bumper of the car in front of them. Jesus said, come follow me. And they jumped in their cars, and they followed him, and they tailed him, and they enjoyed the trip. But then Jesus says, I'm not going to lead anymore. And they're like, I don't know where we're going. I don't have an address. I don't have a map. I don't. So if I don't know where I'm going, if I don't know, like, the destination, I don't know, where do I go tomorrow? How do I know what to do? And Jesus says this. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. What's the destination? Where was Jesus headed? To the Father. He says, if you really knew me, you would know the Father as well. From now on, you do know him, and you have seen him. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father. The Father is the destination. Jesus is the way. You know, if you've never put your faith and your hope and your trust in Jesus Christ, if for all of those people in the world that you've never received the salvation that he offers, like, that's just got to be such a hard life. You don't have a destination set. You don't have a final goal. You have no end game whatsoever. So first of all, in life, you just got to figure out, okay, where am I going? You don't have a preset purpose. And there's some people, they set a purpose, and it's just a subpar purpose, and it leads their life all out of whack. Other people go through their entire life never really establishing what they're living for. And so how in the world are you going to make a daily decisions without knowing where those decisions are going to take you, nor having an end game of where you want them to take you? That's a scary, lost life. But as followers of Jesus, we know our destination, and because of our destination, because we know the goal is to be with the Father, that's what we want. He desires to be with us. We desire to be with him. Therefore, we've got a map. We've got a way. We've got a path. We've got an example on how to get where we're trying to go. And Jesus says, I'm the way to the Father. Does that make sense? So Thomas is saying, hey, what do we do? How do we go on next? Jesus, if you're going to leave, how do we wake up tomorrow and know what to do? How do we have any kind of direction? How do we know how to navigate this thing? How do we know what to do with our lives now? How do I find for me? How do I find another house? How do we find another job like the one that was just presented to me? How do I manage without the dream that I had for me? How do I continue? And Jesus says, you know the way. Follow me. Follow me. You see, when Peter says, why? Jesus says, trust me. When Thomas says, oh, how? Jesus says, follow me. And last, Philip, he throws in his two cents, and he has another question. Really a statement, if you will. Philip said, Lord, show us the Father and that will be enough. Okay, if I were Jesus, this is just a dangerous thing to keep saying. If I were Jesus, I'd have been all kinds of ticked with Peter already, right? Like, are you kidding me? You're going to tell him, stand up and be all bold and tell me you're not going to deny me? I know what you're going to do. You die with me? Yeah, right. And if I hadn't just slapped Peter and left already, I don't know if I could handle Philip's question. I mean, listen to this. Back in verse 7, if you really knew me, this is Jesus speaking to his disciples, if you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you have known him and have seen him. Next word spoken, Lord, show us the Father and that will be enough. We always picture Jesus, like, not we, I don't know. I don't know how you picture Jesus. But so often you see Jesus in this very, like, meek, mild temperament, gentle, kind of speaks in a monotone voice, the kind of voice you'd want to, like, listen to as you're falling asleep, right? I don't think he used his Jesus. I don't think Jesus used his Jesus voice when he responded to Philip here. I mean, and listen to the words. There's obviously this emotional exchange. He says, don't you know me, Philip? Even after I've been you such a long time, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words I say to you are not my own. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing the work. Believe me when I say that I am the Father and the Father, I am in the Father and the Father is in me. Or at least believe in the evidence, the miracles themselves. Listen, Philip, I tell you the truth. Anyone who has faith in me will do what I've been doing. You'll do even greater things than these because I'm going to the Father, and I'll do whatever you ask in my name so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I'll do it. So he says, like, Philip, you're so dense. Do not hear what I'm saying. And if you hear it, have you not seen what I've been doing? Where do you think this miracle stuff came from? It wasn't just came on my own power, but I'm working through the Father. And he goes on to say, he says, listen, I'm going to leave, but where I'm going, I'm going to be right next to the Father. You ask me for anything in my name, me and my Father are one. I'm going to be sitting there right beside him. My whole aim and my whole goal is to make the Father's name look good. So you ask something in my name and in his will, and you better believe I'm going to do it for you. For his glory. So let's break it down. What did Philip really want? Philip wanted more. You know, when all this took place and Jesus pulled the rug out from under him, Philip or Peter's going, why? Thomas is going, well, how? And Philip's saying, well, Jesus, can I have a little more? Can you give us just a little more? Now, I want you to think about who's asking this. This is Philip. This is one of the 12 disciples. This man who's asking for more from Jesus has seen God work in ways that no one else in the history of mankind has ever seen the hand of God move. Right? I mean, this one that he's speaking to is healing lepers and telling crippled people to get up and blind eyes healed. He's raised the dead on 3 separate occasions. He's calling out demons out of people. He's speaking to nature and trees shrivel and a storm is calmed. He has seen the power of God in incredible ways. And yet he still says, but I just need a little bit more. And what's Jesus' answer? I'm enough. Philip, I'm enough. What you have, what you've received, what you've seen, what you've experienced, Philip, you need to know something. I'm enough. That in my name, you can do anything. In my name and in his will, you can ask for anything. You have enough. So, Philip, I know you're scared right now. Philip, I know you're confused right now. Philip, I know you don't understand what's going on, but trust me, lean into me because I'm enough. So, when we walk through those moments, when it seems like God just flipped our circumstances around on us. When it seems, and this is the thing, see, sometimes bad things happen because we make bad choices. Sometimes bad things happen, or maybe not bad, but confusing things happen even as we're doing exactly what God is calling us to do. And that's the part that really is hard to deal with, isn't it? The disciples did nothing wrong. But they had their vision of what God was going to do pigeonholed. I know God is going to do this. Man, I got faith to believe. God is going to do this. And then when he doesn't, we get all kinds of messed up. And we start asking these questions. God, why? I don't understand. God, why? Why are you doing this? God, how am I supposed to get myself out of this now? How am I supposed to face life again? How am I supposed to continue on like nothing happened? How am I supposed to handle this? And God, if you're just going to do all this, God, if I'm going to be left here just undone like this, God, you just got to give me a little bit more. God, I just need to know a little bit more. God, if you can just show me what's around the next corner. God, if you can give me a little bit more insight. God, if you can give me a little bit more direction. God, if you can do just a little bit more in my life or in my families or in my relationship. God, I can handle what you're putting in front of me as long as you just give me a little bit more. And Jesus is saying to us today, I'm enough. So maybe you're walking through one of those times right now. And you're asking, why? Would you hear the words of God today when he says, trust me? You don't have to like his response. But will you follow it? Will you trust him? When nothing seems to make sense right now, will you trust him? Will you trust that he sees more than you can see? Will you trust him that he knows more than you know? Will you trust him that he sees the other side of your circumstances? You know, it doesn't always work out that we ever see the other side. The examples I gave today, and I know there's some of you who are walking through significantly more challenging things than these, but that house that we got denied for. See, our offer was based on the fact that Beth and I both had very, very secure jobs that weren't going anywhere for a very long period of time. And then things happened and Beth lost her job a month later, reducing our monthly income by $1,000, more than $1,000 a month. We wouldn't have been able to make our second month's payment. And then 2 years later, we move, and the housing market at that time, every single year, houses depreciated every year we lived in Illinois. We'd been so upside down, we wouldn't know what to do with it. In the moment, I said, God, I don't understand. This is stupid. Why would you lead us here and then not? And I know he was saying, trust me, because I'm looking out for you. That job, now my good friend has a job. And long story short, I wouldn't trade him jobs if he begged me. I know that I am exactly in the place that God has called me. In the moment, it was so hard. And there have been other moments in life where that's happened, where on the hindsight, where you look back and go, God, I see your hand through it. But do you know what? Truth is, there are some things that you will never, this side of heaven, you will never understand. I believe someday we're gonna get up to heaven and all those things that we're gonna be like, oh, now I get it. But in the meantime, we've got to trust him that he knows things we don't know, and that he's caring for us even when we can't see it. And then we got to follow him. What does that mean? You know, when we're going to God, I don't know how to get out of this. I don't know what to do next. I don't know how I'm supposed to continue. We've got to follow him. And maybe you go, that sounds just as vague as anything. But I want you to see what Jesus was doing in the middle of all this. How do I respond to this situation? How did Jesus respond when he faced his darkest hour? Guess what? He loved to the very end. And he put other people's emotional well-being above his own. He cared for people unlike anybody we've ever seen. So when you're walking through this darkness, when you're walking through this, everything getting flipped on its head, you know what? Instead of being frustrated that you're not a king, how about you start washing somebody's feet? When you get frustrated that things aren't playing out the way they are, how about instead of moping about your circumstance, we would lift the spirits of somebody else around us? Start there. Bottom line, Jesus is enough. I mean, he's there for us. So lean into him. Be it in prayer, be it in worship, be it in his word. Lean into him, because I promise you that he is enough. whatever loss you feel like you've faced, whatever injustice that you're coming up against, whatever change of dreams or plans has come to you, know that He is enough, so lean into Him. Will you trust Him? Will you follow Him? Will you know that He is enough?